The brook trout, native to all the Atlantic coast states from Maine to Georgia, is a cold water, likely vestigial species clinging to indigenous waters carved out some 10,000 years ago, after the retreat of the last significant glaciation. Like other salmonoids, brook trout will often migrate at some time in their life cycle, some even voyaging out into the Atlantic Ocean or large lakes. Migratory behavior occurs before spawning in the fall. This behavior can be curtailed in its southern range, where swimming downstream during late summer months can be met with prohibitive warmer water temperatures and other environmental barriers. The species has persisted despite a multitude of habitat-altering environmental disturbances, most notably disturbances from humans of European origin.
Brook trout is an important species for us to monitor for several reasons. In one of my papers, I describe it as a principal indicator, meaning that if the brook trout can survive and be sustainable in a watershed, then that is an indicator that that entire watershed is pristine.
The state of the species are state fish, brook trout in Virginia. I don't think it's a whole lot different now than it was 10 or 20 years ago. There's no question we're losing brook trout habitat for a variety of reasons. And when we lose brook trout habitat, we lose brook trout. So we have a reduction in, however you want to quantify it, miles, kilometers, meters of stream reach that are hospitable and habitable by brook trout.
Likewise, the absence of brook trout means that there's probably something going on in that watershed that would not be conducive to long-term anyways, to even humans being able to survive. So this could be an indicator 50 years ahead of time, the presence or absence of brook trout.
A team of high school students led by teacher Dr. Kirk Smith are attempting to help combat the disappearance of brook trout by using a mathematical model combined with quick field data collection to provide statistical analysis for various governmental and non-governmental organizations, such as Trout Unlimited and the Virginia Department of Game and Inland Fisheries.
The Sea Club started 2 years ago with six girls. They were sophomore girls, and they were looking for a project that they could do in the community. And so I had conducted some research on assessing brook trout streams. So I asked them if they wanted to do that. And they decided that that was a good project for them to undertake. So we started in the fall of 2014, 2013, right around that area.
If you see the number of streams that are totally been destroyed by what we've been doing, manufacturing, acid rain, etc., 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 and nobody seems to care.
Well, the first thing that really attracted me to the group was Dr. Smith's passion. He absolutely loves these trout, and he is totally invested in making sure that the work we do goes into helping them and protecting them in our area. And then that sort of passion has now moved on to, first it was the leader and the founder, Trina White and Nicole Audia. They share his similar passion for saving these brook trout. And then later on, when Joe took over, Joe Tuttle, he shared that same desire to go out in the field and save these fish. So I love seeing that, and I realized, wow, this is really, really cool, because these people are absolutely committed to making sure that these trout are safe. And then also, I just love that we can go out into the field, we go out into the woods, in the middle of nowhere, and sometimes miss school. It seems like we're just kind of hiking, wading through streams, but I know that we're making a difference by going out and getting this data. Even though we're having so much fun, and we get to get meaningful data and find streams that can support brook trout in a place where we don't have very many brook trout left. I love that we can do both those really great things on one trip.
The mathematical model that we use is a five-dimensional math model. It's very sophisticated, and it uses multivariate statistical analysis. It would be very difficult to do this by hand, so it's in a computer and it's computerized. I have actually simplified all the math down to an Excel spreadsheet where people in the field can actually just enter their field values that they measure. And we're measuring distance to the nearest road, dissolved oxygen in the water, and the water temperature, how much of the watershed is used for agriculture, and then riffle run quality of the 75 meter reach that we choose to monitor.
Yeah, well, when we talk about sustainability, we're trying to think about how people and other organisms can thrive forever. You know, how can we meet our needs and ensure that other living beings in nature can meet their needs at the same time? So for this particular statistic, it really provides an opportunity to look at the interface between human well-being and natural well-being for this particular species and be able to see, okay, are we doing the right things for us and doing the right things by brook trout and the species that live around the brook trout, right? The things that it eat, the things that eat the brook trout. All of these, this whole ecosystem and this food web are reliant upon us interacting in such a way that we're not destroying the physical and biological substrate that they're reliant upon.
Trout Unlimited, a conservation nonprofit organization whose mission is to protect and restore clean waters, has sponsored the group thus far.
Well, I think it's really easy to think it's just a fishing club because it's called Trout Unlimited. So it doesn't really lend itself to a conservation organization until you dig deeper, you go to a meeting, you become a member of Trout Unlimited to understand that, yes, I think if you can find a good sort of balance between, generally in the meetings, we talk about fishing, we talk about fishing techniques, we have speakers that share that with us, but we also talk about and have to encourage the conservation of these streams and the waterways where these fish live, because if we don't do that, we won't have any fish to fish for.
Although the native range of the brook trout is debatable, it is believed to have been the apex fish predator within its native range. Even today, it often retains apex predator status in waters absent of other non-native sport fish, and it did survive the land clearing, agriculture, and logging of the early European pioneers. Perhaps the first major anthropogenic obstacles for brook trout occurred when water-powered mills were brought along streams throughout much of colonial America, which became even more prolific during the 1800s. Many mills operate by diverting most or all of a stream's water through a water wheel system, which severely limits fish movement upstream or downstream. The Industrial Revolution of the mid-1800s brought railroads that allowed human civilization to become significantly entrenched in areas previously too remote for commerce. This provided a conduit to expand agriculture even more and expanded the timber industry into untapped forests. As industry expanded, more brook trout habitat was exposed to human activity.
Well, headwater streams are a lot like the veins in your body in the sense that if you can't move the things that you need through those parts of the stream down to the Chesapeake Bay can't survive. Really, the fish, the plants, and other things that live in the water can extend down this entire continuum from the mountains all the way down through the valleys to the Chesapeake Bay. So you need to have those areas healthy if you want a healthy bay.
The modern agriculture revolution occurred in the mid-20th century. Instead of using livestock to plow a few acres for crops, farmers utilized large machinery for commercial farming. The construction of interstate highways in the early 1960s facilitated the transportation of agricultural products from larger farms in the Midwest. Consequently, local family farms in the East started to disappear, while larger production farms in the Midwest began to prosper. As some of these eastern farms went out of business, natural vegetation began to return. some streams began to recover naturally as more shade and stream bank protection took hold.
So the idea behind the brook trout joint venture was to sort of come into areas and maybe find areas where they were extirpated due to some issue. 1995 Madison County floods. We had massive landslides. It destroyed, it was like a fleet of bulldozers paving down hillsides and removing all the riparian corridor and creating a situation where we had vibrant brook trout populations. A week later, we had, it looked like, you know, a nuclear bomb had gone off and there was no brook trout. There were no brook trout. And as nature restores itself and heals itself, the canopy comes back, the temperatures go back down, the siltation cleans itself up, but the brook trout can't get there. So here we can go in, seed a population into a stream that used to have them, and we were successful in doing that in a couple streams in Madison County. We're in Kinsey Run and Garth Run now, we have excellent populations of raw self-sustaining wild brook trout.
Dr. Smith, in addition to teaching, operates a cattle farm in northeastern West Virginia. He believes that by setting an example for sustainable farming, the practice will grow.
Okay, so the farm that I own in West Virginia, I purchased with the thought of converting it into a sustainable farm as opposed to a conventional, traditional beef farm. And I wanted to do that because during my research, I found that agriculture has a negative impact overall on water quality as it pertains to sustainable brook trout. So I wanted to create a model for other farmers to follow or to look at that could show that we don't have to do away with farming. We don't have to have a negative attitude towards farmers. If anything, we should have a positive attitude. So this is my farm that I purchased a few years back. What I wanted to do is see if I could run a beef operation in a sustainable manner. And what I found out that as far as livestock is concerned, boy, it's probably rare for there to be any sustainable, 100% sustainable farm in the United States for livestock. Okay, so here is the automated trough that I mentioned before. And the system is really unique in that it does not have any water exposed to the atmosphere, to the elements. So water's not evaporating from this system. So you're not wasting water at all. And when the cow needs some water, just sticks its snout through there, and it's just like pushing a button on a water fountain, right? The water pushes this little float down, and the water comes to the surface, and they drink the water that way. It's pretty ingenious. Now, this requires a pump, right? And pumps require electricity, but I'm going to show you some solar panels later that run my pump so that I'm not using any electricity from a coal-fired plant. As what I have here are solar panels, and these five panels provide enough electricity to power my pump and provide water for my cattle year-round. These panels right here. If it were a brook trout stream and we were looking at it like this, like it is now, it definitely would not be sustainable for brook trout because of the silt. And you're gonna hear me talk a lot about silt. And the reason why silt is a big deal is because it's a killer that keeps on killing. Seriously. It kills in so many different ways in so many different places. It robs oxygen from the bottom, not just by covering up the bottom to prevent the oxygen from getting there, but it also has adhering to the sediment or the soil particles, it has elements that can oxidize, and that's taking oxygen out of the water column. So there's a chemical oxygen demand associated with this sediment. I do want to point out over here, you can see that under the pines, it's pretty barren there. And the pines do not provide a lot of nice litter that protect that ground.
So a lot of that soil right under the pines is washing right down into the stream.
In 1904, a fungus known as chestnut blight, originating from imported Asian chestnut trees, was identified as the source of the disease killing the American chestnut, the dominant tree species in the climax forest of the mid-Atlantic United States. The enormity of a healthy, fully grown chestnut tree provided for critical shade cover, cooling headwater streams for brook trout, which need cool water to thrive. Additionally, root masses from these trees would secure the soil and stream banks, protecting the riparian habitat from erosion. In mature forests, heavy rain rarely impacts the soil directly, even in the winter. By the mid-1900s, nearly all the American chestnut trees were gone, and the trout streams were much more vulnerable to the surrounding elements.
It provided a huge amount of stability to these watersheds. As the trees started dying off in the early 1900s, then these watersheds became more and more exposed to the elements, including the sun. And so as these trees disappeared by the mid-1900s, you had these huge open areas with the cover that they did not have before. So usually the oaks and the hickories took over as the dominant species and most of the mountainous areas, and they are very small compared to the original American chestnut.
In an effort to assess a watershed, the bulk of the work the team does involves taking field measurements from various streams in a predetermined randomly selected area. Dr. Smith and the team document watershed and in-stream characteristics, as well as water flow. The Brook Trout Index provides a means to compare watersheds to one another and to indicate changes in a watershed over time.
Here we are. This is it.
The brook trout as well. Not to mention that it's unsightly. Oh yeah. That actually looks like a trash bag or something. So I imagine this stream right here would probably have the ideal cobble size in the bed of the stream. And I'm just guessing here, that this has been filled with sediment
from the
path that's right near here that's used by the all-terrain vehicles. Now, there are some other things about this stream that tell me that it's probably not ideal for brook trout, but I would say that just the sediment in there, the sand and the sediment alone, the amount that's in there, automatically takes this off the list as an ideal stream.
Yeah.
I mean, without looking at any of the other problems it might have, you can look at this right away and just say, okay, this is not a candidate stream for brook trout.
So Bullhorn Mountain trip was one of the first actual trips we did to get actual information and data, and it was very successful. We went to the Bullhorn Mountain Wildlife Preserve towards Manassas, and we met up with a ranger who we had met before. His name is Robert Stewart, and he works for the VOF, which is the Virginia Outdoors Foundation. He's a very cool guy, helped us, showed us around and such, and we had actually been there prior in the fall to test out our equipment and such, and that had went very well, and it's a great place, and Robert showed us around, and it was a great expedition because we got all the things we wanted to do accomplished. We tried all our different testing methods. We tested flow using an apple. The meters were all working very well. I made sure everyone knew how to use those. And we went to a much larger section of the creek than we did initially the first time we went there.
Then we have the problem with an old pond area up here where the dam washed out during one of the hurricanes in the 1970s.
First thing I want to say is safety comes first. All right,
even though we do have Steven with us. Safety is first.
Oh, got him.
Yeah, I was saying in the truck, I said, if somebody could be born with a tattoo, it would be Steven. Right? So, fearless. Man is fearless. So when
we go out and we do these watershed assessments, they are very fast, quick assessments, and you know, you have to take into consideration you're measuring quantity versus quality. And so we have a little bit of quantity of information, so it's going to give us relatively good quality, and that's why this model is a good model. However, it's not the end all. The answers that we get from doing these assessments don't determine absolutely whether or not any particular watershed is suitable or even not suitable for brook trout.
We're gonna go upstream because presently Fish and Game does not think that the brook trout are surviving here. They don't see any evidence of a sustainable population. However, I believe they haven't been upstream because it's really rough to hike through that, but we're gonna do it. And we're gonna check upstream to see if we can find any pools where there might be brook trout. So that's one of our goals today. And also we're gonna check the central site here. We were here last year, so we would have 2 years, consecutive years of data. We could possibly see some changes from 1 year to the next.
We pass the information on to the professional biologists that make the ultimate decision. What's good about our model, what's good about what we do, is that it is very cost effective, very inexpensive, it's fast, and it does not require a lot of time or money invested up front by the people that are actually doing the assessment. And just about any volunteer group can be trained to do this. That's the beauty of it. Gets people involved in doing work outside, and it makes the folks that are actually doing the surveys feel like they're part of the decision making that goes into deciding whether or not a particular watershed is suitable for brook trout.
All right.
Watch out, the distilled water. Check if there's distilled water.
Do you have the apple? Does anyone have the apple?
This is nothing.
I will.
So we've got five flags set up. These flags mark the central site, and then we've got two downstream and two upstream, and they mark the five transects that we use. And those basically mark where we collect the data. And then at each transect, we collect 10 depth readings across the width of the stream.
Okay, so we're measuring the stream and then marking specific points out along the tape measure. And then we're measuring both the depth of the stream at that point and the and the type of rock that we find there. So like a kind of rock about the size of your fist, just like a stone, and then a little bit bigger is cobble. Then you've got one of those big ones over there is boulder. And each of them has a different value that we then put into Dr. Smith's equation.
Really
no attempt.
And there's really not. Okay, so just right at the end. Hey, Joe.
Nice story.
If you flow fast, like here, you wouldn't have to slow. But there, it's not.
Yeah, congrats. Okay, ready? Set. Alright, so we're using the apple to measure stream flow, which is mostly used to measure stream discharge, which is the volume of water moving through the stream. So we're measuring a certain distance that the apple travels and how long it takes to travel to measure the velocity. And then velocity times the cross-sectional area of the stream will give you discharge.
I really enjoy the odd apple or two.
This probe measures the flow of the stream and
the propeller.
Yeah, the propeller will spin around, and that will tell us how many times it spins around.
You can give Tanya an app. You can
put like three big rocks.
And I put the net facing downstream, and then I place three large rocks on the net to hold it down. And I'm doing this like dance so I can dig up sediment and like have macro invertebrates come into the net.
Hold it by the flat.
Where?
Right there.
Yeah, that's a mock river. Okay, let me go get the ice cubes.
There's another right there.
What are we seeing?
So there's one right there.
One there.
What is it?
Mock rivers.
Do they each get their own cube?
No, they each put them in the same cube.
Okay, that one, yeah.
We like to group them by appearance before we identify them.
Okay.
So we got the pH meter down here and the conductivity meter, and we already did the pH, and we already just did the conductivity. We got the temperature from that as well, and we're going to be using this, which is a dissolved oxygen meter, in order to get dissolved oxygen solids and the temperature as well. Because all three of the meters read temperature, so we're using all three to get a reliable reading on that.
We want to make sure that we use two different probes just to confirm that our data is correct. That's one of Dr. Smith's big things that he always reminds us. You know, we want to make sure our data is correct over and over and over. So those two different meters, they're a way for us to check that, oh, the dissolved oxygen that this one has is the same as this one. And if it's not, then we have to recalibrate in the field, which is fine. We always do that before every outing anyway. But it's a very important part of our scientific method to make sure that our numbers are exact.
Yeah, we can do an adjustment for
Okay. Yeah. So here we have the substrate here appears to be covered with algae. When it clings to the rocks like that, we call that form of algae growth periphyton, because it's actually growing on the substrate as opposed to free floating algae in the water column. So the excess nutrients cause the periphyton to grow.
Or is it meters?
And this inhibits a lot of the macro invertebrate activity, because it covers up the bottom in areas where these macroinvertebrates would hide or find food. So it's a limiting environment for the very food that the brook trout would be eating.
So we're trying to collect macroinvertebrates. Yeah, this isn't exactly the ideal way to do it, but ideally, depending on what lives in the stream bed, the stream either has good quality if it has a lot of intolerant insects, so insects that can't survive if there's a lot of pollution. If there's a lot of tolerant and not a lot of intolerant insects, that probably means the stream's pretty polluted. So it's kind of like a biological indication of what the stream's like.
So the app we use is called Collector, and it was released by Esri, and they're a mapping software company. It's designed to work with ArcGIS, their main mapping platform. Basically, Collector allows us to create data points on a map. It's very, very visual based, where we can go out into the field, drop a point on wherever we're working, and then fill in a bunch of data fields for whatever information we need. The hardest part about a lot of other data collection software is that you can't use it when you're out of cell service, and that often happens when we're in the field working on a stream. So Collector app allows me to cache a given region on a map. Say I know I'm going to work on Difficult Run, I can cache an area around that stream and then save it to my phone. So it's like having a paper map, but it's all on my phone. And then we can still edit and add points as we work. without having to worry about that cell service.
With students collecting data, as opposed to paid scientists, the question arises as to whether or not the data is credible. Dr. Smith believes it certainly can be, as long as the students pay careful attention to their instruments and data.
So one of the things that I've tried to instill on the students before we go out to the field is that this is not a field trip. We're actually doing real science. And so when you do real science, there are some constraints as to what you can do and what you can't do. You just don't pull an instrument out of the box and then start taking measurements.
One of the main questions that surrounds our group is, are high school students responsible and capable of doing this kind of work? And so obviously it was incredibly important that all of our data be like good data and reliable data. So to this end, a lot of people might not see this, but I really made sure that all of our instruments were on point, calibrated in every way possible. And we even, to verify the quality of our DO readings, we got another dissolved oxygen meter and compared the readings against our current one. And we were able to have good quality control that way because we got consistent readings on both, so we were sure that they were good readings. And so that is incredibly important for our team, and it's something that I focused very hard on.
And when it comes to the issue of whether students or non-scientific organizations can collect good data, well, the reality is that all data can be lousy or good depending on how well it's collected. We can go out there and grab a little bit and see how it works and compare it and cross-validate it, just like we would do between scientists to see the quality of that information.
So in the spring of 2016, April 2016, we ended up presenting at Environment Virginia, which was a symposium for mostly professional organizations. These are consultants and people, government agencies, and some state agencies as well. To my knowledge, I believe we were the only high school group to present there.
I loved the VMI trip. I thought it was really, really cool being able to talk to professionals. I've never interacted with people from that environment, especially adults, that do the kind of work that we do for a living. And it was also really, really great to see people who are also interested in what we're doing. Here at Madison, it's, oh, cool, you have a trout club. Do you fish? No. Not many people are interested in what we do. But as soon as we got out to that conference, people said, oh, wow, that's really, really cool. And we could talk in detail about our method and what we do. So that was a big change from what I'm used to here at Madison.
And part of what we do is brook trout habitat sustainability. The issue that we deal with primarily is, in this age of climate change and habitat destruction, how do we ensure that species can adapt or that we can help them adapt?
We can create a system where Loudoun County schools, counties throughout the state of Virginia can all interact and collaborate on a similar database. We've created a unified methodology, a unified system for collecting data where now we can share this with other people and we can have other high schools. Professional groups such as Trout Unlimited, we've worked closely with them in the past, or the Department of Game and Inland Fisheries here in Virginia, they can also look at that data.
We need to be doing a better job. We don't teach our children really about the environment. We don't teach them about the issues, and that's why we have this whole new program about going in the grade schools, getting them out of the schools, and letting them visit some of our great treasures so that they understand, oh, I understand this, and maybe I ought to pay attention and start studying it.
You know, serendipity. I mean, we just happened upon him and the Department of Natural Resources secretary. I expressed to her that what the governor would like to see in education, that we were already doing that, and that I thought that the governor might want to know more about what we're doing.
I'm trying to transform Virginia high schools. High schools in America don't work anymore. They don't. They are big buildings with classrooms with seats. And you get credit for sitting in seats. I would rather see core courses earlier in high school. Everybody who comes into high school ought to know the environmental jobs, the hot space. They ought to know that there's 17,000 cyber jobs. Maybe I should take some computer science, maybe some code writing. And then your junior, senior year, I'd rather see you out getting some industry credentials. Go out and spend a little time in industry.
The students did all the talking, I didn't say anything. The students did the presentations. They went extremely well. And the governor was impressed with what we were doing. And then the subsequent meeting with the Secretary of Department of Natural Resources, I think was even more fruitful. We were able to get into the actual details of what we do and how we do it. I think we did emphasize quality control, which is something I emphasize with the group. And the secretary was really impressed.
Now that we have this method, we can begin to share it with others. And I think that's the future of the club. We can say, already we've contacted a group in Richmond at a public school down there, and they're already doing similar things that we are. So we can take our method and reach out to Loudoun County Schools, Richmond, anywhere in the state, and say, hey, we're doing this. It's a very simple system. We have one meter that we have to use. We can help you find grants to do this. And now anyone at their high school can go out into the field, use our method because we've unified it and established one, and collect data. That data can be shared with Department of Game and Inland Fisheries if they need it. More importantly, it can be shared with Trout Unlimited. So Trout Unlimited can see all of this data for streams upon stream upon stream, that they wouldn't have had access to before this club. And now they can identify where they'd like to stock trout.
And so if there's not an appreciation that has been developed at an early age or ever, then when push comes to shove and there is a move to expand a highway or build a new shopping center or build a new golf course that might destroy pristine habitat for any kind of fish or wildlife species, then the inclination may be more to go toward development, human development, than to conserve a species. That's my concern, and it's a deep concern of mine.